All right, guys, we're back staring at my engine bay, and in this video we are going to talk about ignition timing. And a lot of you know ignition timing is really important for the B58. Our cars like running a lot more timing than maybe some other platforms that you're used to, but maybe you don't really know what ignition timing is or how to look at it in your logs and things like that. So we're going to go ahead and talk about that now. So ignition timing is actually pretty simple to understand when you think about how an engine works. You know, at the bottom, you have your crankshaft rotating around, and it's connected to your piston at the top that's going up and down. And there's going to be a certain point at the top of the piston stroke where you're going to want that combustion process to occur. So when combustion happens, it creates a bunch of cylinder pressure, and that explosion pushes the piston down, continues rotating the crankshaft, and that's what translates to, you know, your drive shaft and out to your wheels and turns into the torque and horsepower that we're all looking for. But you don't necessarily want that combustion process to happen right at the top dead center point, because it's going to take a little bit of time for the air fuel mix in the cylinder to completely burn, and that's where ignition timing comes into play. So ignition timing is what we use to advance how early the spark fires so that the combustion process has a little bit of time to complete before the piston starts traveling back down again. So you're never going to see this on your B58, hopefully, but just for illustrative purposes, I'll use this as an example. Say you have 45 degrees of timing advance. You can kind of see right at top dead center, that would be zero. So 45 degrees away from there, the spark plug would fire. And while the crank is rotating from 45 all the way to zero, you're going to see the combustion process complete, and then it's going to push the piston back down. So that's really what ignition timing does. It allows you to either advance or retard the timing so that it can spark at the perfect time. Now, ignition timing is still a pretty fine line. You're going to have a point where it can perfectly ignite the air fuel mix at the right time and make the maximum amount of power and torque, burn up the right amount of fuel, and basically create a nice, safe combustion process. But if you do it too late, you're going to sacrifice a lot of power. You're going to basically complete that process while the piston is already traveling down, and so that's going to reduce how much power and torque your car is going to make. Now, on the other end, if you have too much ignition timing, that can actually damage things, because you can run into a scenario where the piston is moving up in its stroke, but the combustion process is completing and that pressure is pushing it back down, and they're basically fighting against each other. So that can damage things, it can crack pistons, it can bend rods, and cause a lot of really bad scenarios. So you definitely don't want too much ignition timing either. Now, our cars do a good job of trying to predict if our engine has too much ignition timing. So if one of the sensors indicates that there's an unsafe condition, it will do what we call timing pull, or if you're looking at a log, it might be called timing corrections. And that's where you'll see basically there's a timing target, and it'll pull maybe like 1.5 degrees or 3 degrees or something like that to reduce and retard the timing advance so that it's not firing as early as it was basically planning on. So when that happens, you might make a little bit less power, but it's at least keeping the engine safe. Now, there are a lot of things that can cause timing corrections. A really common one is just temperature fluctuation. When things are hotter, it's going to be harder to run really high timing advance. Hotter air coming in is going to translate to hotter IATs, so just warmer weather outside can negatively impact it. Or if you don't have adequate cooling, then that can negatively impact your timing as well. And when that hot air gets into the combustion chamber, it's not as dense, so you can't advance the timing as much because there's not as much air and oxygen to actually burn. So in those cases, you'll want less timing advance because you're not going to be able to take advantage of it. Another one that a lot of people talk about are spark plugs and spark plug gap. Now, in my testing, I have not seen a significant improvement by doing any changes to the spark plug gap. Even up to 600 plus horsepower, I seem to have really good results with the stock plugs and the stock gap. So that's usually what I recommend. Some people have seen improvements going from NGK to Champion. So you can kind of try that yourself and see if it works. But I know a lot of people that have good luck with the NGK OEM plugs as well. Now, the last thing and the one that has always made the biggest difference in my testing is gas quality and octane. So just to be clear, timing corrections are not the end of the world. It's something that happens all the time, and it's just a built-in safety for your car. Anytime you fill up with gas in your tank and every time you're driving around, that gas quality is going to vary. So sometimes it'll pull timing and sometimes it won't. It's really not anything out of the ordinary, but if you want to have the cleanest timing possible, adding 1 to 2 gallons of race gas or E85 does wonders. So if I'm running a pump gas off the shelf map, I might add 1 or 2 gallons of E85 and my timing will get much better. If I'm running like an E30 or an E40 mix, I'll bump up my ethanol content to like E35 or E45. And again, that will make my timing much more consistent and I won't even have to think about it. So for me, that has always made the biggest difference. And that's usually what I recommend to people. You know, if you don't have a lot of room to improve your cooling, it's just hot, middle of summer or whatever, try to find a way to add some ethanol or race gas to your tank to bump up the octane and improve your gas quality, and that will make your car much more consistent. Now let's talk about our logs really quick. So I'll show you guys a couple examples of what I look at when I'm paying attention to ignition timing. Now what you should expect to see is, you know, you floor it and you're going to see the ignition timing slowly rise up as you go towards redline. Now the reason why it goes up is because your RPMs are going up. And when your RPMs go up, your piston is traveling at a faster speed. So you need to physically ignite the system earlier to compensate for that reduced window for the combustion process to happen. Think about it like if you're coming up to a stop sign, if you're coming up to it at 60 miles an hour, you need to hit the brakes earlier than you would if you were coming up to it at 20 miles an hour. So it's the same thing with your car. If you're at 6,000 RPM, you need to ignite the air fuel mix earlier than you would at, you know, 3,000 RPM, because there's less time between where the piston is and when it'll be at top dead center. Now, as far as corrections are concerned, I usually look to keep things below 3. It's going to happen on a cylinder by cylinder basis because we have really high frequency sensors on the car that try to identify exactly which cylinder is having an issue before it does any timing pull. So if one cylinder pulls timing 3 degrees or less, and usually it ends up catching up as it gets towards redline, and it's just kind of like, you know, some freak issue or whatever while you're driving, I consider that not to really be a problem, because that will happen from time to time. But if you're pulling more than 3 degrees of timing, or you're just seeing erratic timing across all of the cylinders, then that's usually when I would try to address it. It seems to be kind of hard to do that with everybody running off-the-shelf maps. Custom tuning, of course, is much easier and better to dial in for your specific car and setup. But if you have an off-the-shelf map, like I said, either improving your cooling or increasing your octane will usually give you the best results. Now, one thing that a lot of us see is cylinder one, for whatever reason, just always pulls timing first and always pulls the most timing. At this time, I still don't understand why that is. I think it has something to do with the way the airflow is going through the intake manifold. The same way we struggle with getting fuel to cylinder six if you do, you know, single point fuel injection in your charge pipe. I think there's an issue that we have with the airflow getting to cylinder one, and so it just seems to always be the first one to pull timing. So whatever the problem is, that is normal. And if you see that in your car, that doesn't necessarily mean cylinder one's failing or something like that. It's just a characteristic of the B58. So yeah, I think that covers everything. I know there's a lot to discuss about ignition timing, so if there's something I missed, feel free to reach out and ask me questions. I am still helping people review their logs when I can, so if that's something that you need some help with, feel free to reach out, send me a message with a link to, you know, your data's app or your boot mode logs, and I can take a look. So yeah, that's it for this video. Thank you guys for watching, and I hope this helps. And if you have any other questions or comments, leave them down below. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do